Simon & Schuster Audio presents Evil Spy School by Stuart Gibbs. Read by Gibson, Frazier.
August 30. 2. Regarding my covert field research has confirmed the worst. SPYDER definitely has a new diabolical plot underway, and they have started to staff it. Steps must be taken immediately to determine and given that the three of us are known to SPYDER and thus unable to infiltrate their organization effectively, and that the CIA has certainly been compromised by enemy agents, we are left with no choice but to activate Benjamin Ripley for Operation Bedbug. The mission is unsanctioned and unapproved. It is not to be discussed with anyone, anywhere, no matter how much you think you can trust them. This is especially true for For his own safety, even young Mr. Ripley cannot be informed of what is truly going on until we are sure that If anyone has any doubts about Mr. Ripley's ability to serve in this capacity, now is the time to voice them. The consequences of his failure on this mission would be disastrous. Unless I hear from you, the mission will commence on September 3 at 1100 hours. God bless America.
Chapter 1. Heavy Artillery. Battle Zone. September 3, 1100 hours. I ran as fast as my legs could carry me. 7 enemy agents in hot pursuit. I had spent a great deal of time preparing for this moment. I had practiced self-defense. I had studied how to remain calm under pressure. I had read everything I could find on mortal combat. And so I had hoped that when the time came and I found myself in the thick of battle, I would be able to handle myself with cool, spy-like aplomb. Instead, I was screaming. Thankfully, it wasn't a girly shriek. It was more of a sustained, "Ah!" which could be roughly translated as, "I'm in serious trouble! Someone please help me!" It's one thing to study action sequences. It's a whole other thing to find yourself in the middle of one. I dodged through piles of dirt and debris, aware the agents were gaining on me. They were all screaming too, although this was more of a war cry. Translation, "Once we catch you, you're dead meat!" I was dressed for combat, clad from head to toe in camouflage gear. But it obviously wasn't working, because the enemy could see me perfectly well. Sniper fire whistled past me. Something screeched through the air high above and exploded in the distance. Not far ahead, a foxhole came into view. To most people, it would have looked like just a big, grubby hole in the dirt, but to me, it was beautiful. I shouted into my radio headset, "Erica, I'm coming in hot!" "Okay," Erica replied calmly. "I'm ready." She didn't sound like she was in the heat of battle at all. Instead, she sounded bizarrely relaxed, as though she were lounging in a hammock at a beach resort. I leapt into the foxhole. It was 4 feet deep. Erica Hale sat inside, leaning against the dirt wall, casually leafing through a Guns and Ammo magazine despite all the chaos around her. Like me, she was wearing camouflage gear, but somehow she looked stylish in hers. Then again, Erica would have looked stylish in a potato sack. She was the most beautiful girl I'd ever met, as well as the smartest, the most athletic, and the deadliest. "There's a horde of enemy agents right behind me," I panted, "heavily armed. They ambushed me as I was nearing the objective."
"Ben, take it easy," Erica calmly tucked the magazine into her knapsack. "What are you so worked up about?"
"They're going to be here any second," I exclaimed, "and they're ruthless."
"They're 12 years old," Erica said flatly. She had a good point. They were only 12, and the war around us was merely a combat simulation. We were in the midst of our traditional survival and combat skills assessment exam at the CIA's Academy of Espionage. Our weapons were only paintball guns, and the battlefield was a mock-up on the Academy firing range. But it felt real enough.
"Some of them are pretty big 12-year-olds, I said defensively.
Their war cry was growing louder. They were almost upon us.
"How many of them are there?" Erica asked.
7. In one fluid movement, Erica sprang to her feet and fired her paintball gun over the lip of the foxhole. 5 shots,
each punctuated by the yelp of someone being hit squarely by a paint-filled projectile. Erica took cover, grinning. "Now there's only two," she informed me. If there was anyone you wanted in your foxhole, it was Erica Hale. Although she was only 15, she was easily the most talented spy in training at school. She'd practically been preparing for it since birth. Spying was her family business. Most of her ancestors had been spies, going all the way back to Nathan Hale in the Revolutionary War. Her grandfather, Cyrus Hale, was one of the best there'd ever been, and he'd taught Erica almost everything he knew. On the other hand, I came from a long line of grocers. I was only 13, and until 7 months earlier, my entire espionage experience had consisted of watching James Bond movies. Since then, however, I'd twice been involved in thwarting the plots of SPYDER, a secretive subversive organization dedicated to causing chaos and mayhem. Thus, I'd seen far more action than most of my fellow students. But that didn't mean I was comfortable in the heat of battle, be it real or pretend. Today was a good example. It was our first day back at school for the fall semester, time for the annual survival and combat skills assessment. When I was inducted, it was the middle of the school year, so my SAXA had been a solo exam. But now the school administration had to assess the entire first-year class and reassess all the returning students at the same time. There were 6 grades, 7th through 12th, with 50 kids in each. 300 people. Thus the full-scale fake battle. The school had been divided into 2 teams. Red, them, and blue, us. Each was assigned to steal a heavily guarded objective from the other side while protecting their own. It was basically an enormous, potentially painful version of Capture the Flag. Since it was only a game, and the kids who'd been chasing me were all newbies, I probably should have been as calm as Erica. But I wasn't. I was still on edge, terrified of screwing up in front of the professors, who were watching closely from the sidelines and grading our performance. "Did you only have 5 paintballs in your ammo clip?" I asked Erica. "No," she replied. "I have plenty." "Then why didn't you take out all 7 enemy agents?" Erica shrugged. "What fun would that be?" With a primal scream, the 2 remaining newbies leapt into our foxhole, guns primed, ready to paint us cherry red. One of them was staggeringly large for a boy his age. He was built like a sequoia tree. The other was a surprisingly small girl. She looked like a heavily armed elf. Thankfully, Erica took the guy. Before he could get a shot off, she'd launched herself into action, sweeping his legs out from under him and wrenching his gun away. Then she dispatched him with a shot to the chest, coating his torso in blue paint. I attacked the girl. Felt a bit mean to attack an elf, but this one was aiming a gun at me. I wasn't as adept as Erica, but my fighting skills had improved at school. Before I'd arrived, I wouldn't have been able to beat a small girl in a fight. Now I could. It wasn't very chivalrous, but my grade was on the line. I shoved the elf's gun aside as she fired. The paintball whizzed past me, leaving a red splotch on the side of the foxhole. Then I barreled into her, knocking her flat as I snapped the gun from her grasp. I swung it around, preparing to blast her. Only the elf started crying. "Stop!" she wailed. "I quit!" "You quit?" I asked, thrown. I don't think you can do that." "I thought I could hack it here, but I was wrong," the elf sobbed. "It's too hard. I want to go home. I want my mommy." I lowered the gun, feeling bad for how hard I'd knocked her down. "Sorry, spy school's not for everyone." "Like you?" The elf's crying suddenly stopped. The whole "I want my mommy" thing had been an act. I tried to shoot her, but she lashed out a leg, catching me behind the knee. I crashed to the ground, the gun tumbling from my grasp. The elf pounced on it and swung the barrel toward me. Erica blew her away. She fired 6 times, coating the elf in blue, then pointed to the sidelines. "Nice try, newbie, but you're out." The elf now looked like a smurf, a really angry one.
"You got lucky this time," she sneered at me. "Next time, your girlfriend might not be around to save you."
Then she stormed off toward the morgue on the sidelines, where her fellow paint-splattered corpses watched the battle play out.
"I'm not his girlfriend," Erica yelled after her.
I staggered back to my feet, brushing myself off. Man, that girl was devious. She was, Erica agreed. She'll do well here. I watched the elf trudge past the reviewing stands. Professor Kuklinski, who taught advanced biochemical weaponry, appeared disappointed in her performance, while Professor Greenwald Smith,
who taught counterespionage, seemed to be giving her some words of encouragement. Next to them, Professor Crandall, who taught self-preservation, had dozed off in his chair.
"You know," I said to Erica, "when normal kids go back to school, their first day is all about getting oriented and meeting their teachers. There's no paint guns or fighting or pretending to kill one another."
"Really?" Erica asked. "It must suck to be normal."
I pried a clod of dirt from my ear, then scoped out the battlefield around us. I'd probably better get back in the game before I get dinged for slacking off.
"Hold on," Erica said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.